This morning, we're going to be preaching out of John chapter 4, verses 43 through 54. And I'm going to go ahead and read that passage of scripture to you real quick, and then we're going to get started. Amen? All right. John 4, starting in verse 43. It says, now after 2 days, he departed thence, meaning he left there and he went into Galilee. For Jesus himself testified that a prophet has no honor in his own country. Then when he was come into Galilee, the Galileans received him, having seen all the things that he did at Jerusalem at the feast, for they also went unto the feast. You know what? Let's just real quick go backwards to chapter 2. And where I want you to see here is that starting in verse 11. This is after, starting in verse 11 is after he changed the water into wine in Cana. Okay? And that's important for you to remember because it has a little something to do with our story this morning. But starting in verse 11, it says, this beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. After this, he went down to Capernaum, he and his mother and his brethren and his disciples, and they continued there not many days. And the Jews' Passover was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of money sitting. And when he had made a scourge, meaning a small whip of small cords, he drove them all out of the temple and the sheep and the oxen and poured out the changers of money and overthrew the tables. And said unto them that sold doves, take these things hence, make not my father's house a house of merchandise. And his disciples remembered that it was written, the zeal of thine house hath eaten me up. And then answered the Jews and said unto him, what sign showest thou unto us? Think about that. What sign showest thou unto us, seeing that you do these things? In other words, you show us a sign to show us that you really have the authority to come in here, us, the religious leaders of the time, and rebuke us and scourge us and turn over these tables and act the way that you are. We want a sign. We want you to prove that you have the authority to do what it is that you say that you can do. And it says, verse 20, then said the Jews, I'm sorry, it says right here, verse 19, Jesus answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. So they wanted a sign, so Jesus told them, that's the sign you're going to get. Destroy the temple, and I will raise it up in 3 days. Then said the Jews, 46 years was this temple in building, and you will rear it up in 3 days? Verse 21, but he spoke of the temple of his body. When therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this unto them, and they believed the scriptures and the word which Jesus had said. Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover in the feast day, many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. So they believed in him when they saw the miracles that he did. But Jesus did not commit himself unto them because he knew all men and needed not that any should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. The point is that Jesus knew that there were many people that were seeking after him and supposedly believing in him and on his name, but it was only because they saw the power that he wielded and they saw the miracles that he was able to perform. And the reality of it is that this is something that Jesus dealt with throughout the entirety of his ministry. Matter of fact, after he turned, what was it, 5 fish and 3 loaves, I believe it was. And I know there's 2 different occurrences and I'm shooting from the hip. But after he fed the multitude, they followed him over when he went over the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and they were, because they were thronging him and wanting to follow him. And what he told them was this. He said, you don't follow me because you saw the miracles. Well, what are you talking about, Jesus? They sat right there and they watched you turn these fish into, you know, and you fed them. Of course they saw it. He said, but instead, because your bellies were filled. His point was, is that no, you didn't see properly the miracles, what they were testifying to you, the testimony that they spoke to you. What they spoke to you is that I'm the anointed one that was sent from the Father. The Father has a plan, and the kingdom of God now has come upon you. And what you're seeking after is something to fill your belly. What you're seeking after is something to fix your your temporary pleasures. What you want from me is for me to fix your immediate circumstances. But what you need to understand and what you need to know is that the Father has a plan, amen? And he's, amen. And I am the plan, and you need to learn how to truly believe in me and allow the plan of the Father and the plan of God to begin to work in the midst of your life. It's not just about what you want in the midst of this life. Amen? And so I wanted you to see that, and the reason that I interjected that in there is because it says right here in verse 45, back in chapter 4 of John, where we were reading, it says in verse 45, then when he was coming to Galilee, the Galileans received him, having seen all the things that he did at Jerusalem at the feast, for they also went to the feast. So the Galileans were at the feast. You remember on the map, this is the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan River, the Dead Sea, and the Mediterranean Sea is the western border. And so this is the Sea of Galilee. So this whole region here is the region of Galilee. And Cana is here, and Capernaum is over here, and Jerusalem is down here. And so this whole, once again, this whole region is Galilee. This is Samaria, and this is Judea, or Judah, the southern portion, and Israel, or the region of Galilee, is up here at the top. And so the point is that Jesus was up here in the region of Galilee, and the Galileans, that area there, what it's saying is that they also had traveled down to Jerusalem to be part of this Passover feast, because that's what they had to do. At least three times a year, they had to travel down to Jerusalem to engage in these feasts, which all typified Jesus in the Old Testament and all painted a picture, amen, of Jesus that was going to come and the work that he would do. And so they would engage in this form of worship. And while they were down there, they saw what Jesus did when he made the scourge and he drove off the money changers and he spoke with authority and he rebuked the religious leaders. And they also saw the miracles that he performed. And so now he's on another trip. He's taken the same pathway. He's in Cana now. And he's in the area of Galilee. And it says that the people of Galilee, verse 45, when he was coming to Galilee, the Galileans received him, having seen all the things that he did at Jerusalem at the feast, for they also went into the feast. So Jesus came again unto Cana of Galilee, where he made the wine. And there was a certain nobleman. So there's already a history behind Jesus. He shows up back in this same town. He's already performed a miracle. Amen. Would you imagine that this miracle was not noised abroad, that it wasn't voiced to all the inhabitants of the town? The young couple, they got married, they ran out of wine. Now, when I preached that, I explained to you that that was a major social, for lack of words, better lack of words, faux pas. You don't run out of wine whenever you are having a wedding in Israel in these times. And we're not going to get into what the wine was all about and all that. They weren't, listen, let's not go there. But the point is this, is that an internal miracle took place. Jesus transformed the internal contents of the vessel. We're talking about the heart. But physically, he saved this couple from social disgrace. And at the same time, I'm telling you, it was voiced abroad that Jesus of Nazareth performed a miracle, and now he's back in the same city, the same location where he was then, whenever he did. And here we have the story begins to, that we're preaching this morning, begins to shape up. It says, there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. Then said Jesus unto him, except ye see signs and wonders, you will not believe. Same situation that he dealt with whenever he was in Jerusalem. It says that he tells them, give us a sign. Show us what authority you have to do these things that you do. He said, I'm going to tell you what sign you're going to see. Tear down this temple and I'll raise it back up in 3 days. He also told him another time when they asked him that, the only sign that you will see is the sign of the prophet Jonah, who was in the belly of a fish for 3 days and three nights. Once again, talking about his death, talking about his burial, talking about his resurrection. Why did he speak that way? He told his disciples, I speak to you in parables, a mystery language. Because for you, it's, I want you to know what it is. I'll give you the interpretation. Purposely don't want them to know because they don't really want to know. People say, in a conversation that I was having with this same person yesterday that I told you about, that was talking about people too focused on the rapture, the same exact person made the comment about, listen, people don't understand the Bible when they read it. I don't understand the Bible when I read it. That's because the Bible, the natural mind, according to the book of Corinthians, cannot perceive the things of God. They're spiritually understood. The things of God, and listen, it doesn't matter whether you're a Christian or not. You can be a Christian operating with a carnal mindset. You need to cry out to God and ask the Holy Ghost to cause the spiritual scales to fall from your eyes and that He would give you revelation of the Scripture so that when you read it and believing that it's the inspired Word of God, that it will fill you up and that it will speak to you and that it will be your compass as you walk upon this earth. As a matter of fact, I've told this person and I've told other people before, the problem that we have is that you don't believe that the Scriptures are inspired by God. Amen. And if you don't believe that God wrote the book, then you're not going to be able to understand what it is that He's trying to speak to you because you have a lack of faith regarding God's communication to mankind.
That's right.
When you're willing to believe that God communicates to mankind through His Word, that His Word is inspired, hallelujah, the Holy Spirit will begin to reveal truth to you.
Yeah.
He will begin to reveal these things to you that you need, amen? And so, it goes on to say that this nobleman, when he heard that Jesus was there in verse 47, he went unto Him and he besought Him that He would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. And then Jesus said, except you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. The nobleman said unto Him, sir, come down ere my child die. Jesus saith unto him, go your way, your son lives. And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. And as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, your son liveth. Then inquired he of them the hour when he began to amend. And they said unto him, yesterday, at the seventh hour, the fever left him. So the father knew that it was at the same hour in the which Jesus said unto him, thy son liveth, and himself believed, and his whole house. This is again the second time, this is again the second miracle that Jesus did when he was come out of Judea into Galilee. And so I titled this morning's message, A Fever Unto Death. Because what we see here is a situation where basically the essence of the story is that there's a problem, amen, that we need Jesus to solve. And the problem is that there's a child and he's sick. And the only thing that we don't know what the sickness is. All we know is that there's a fever connected to it. And so that's what I titled this morning's message, A Fever Unto Death. Now, one of the first things, a couple things I wanted to talk to you about was I just wanted to kind of set up the situation a little bit because I think there's some spiritual significance in all of this. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about the geography of the situation. I already wrote on the board for you, and I'm going to have a couple of maps that Cana was a little bit to the west of Capernaum, and it was about a 20-mile journey. All right. Now, 20 miles may not seem like a whole lot to you. I've run a couple of marathons. 27 miles is a pretty good little haul. It's not an easy journey. But I also want to talk to you a little bit more about the fact of it's not just geography and how many miles there is, but topography. And what I mean by that is that Cana of Galilee was at a 1,500-foot elevation, whereas Capernaum was at about 650. So you're looking at close to 1,000 feet of elevation. So basically what you're looking at is almost a straight uphill walk through rocky hill country. All right? And so I put a couple of maps, and this one here you see is basically the same thing that I drew for you, the proximity of Cana to Capernaum. Now, one of the things that I will note to you as we study the Bible together and we learn how to study the Bible is that the man makes a comment. He says, come down ere my child die. Well, if you look, Capernaum's a little bit north of Cana. So, and they're over here. The nobleman's come here. So why would he say come down? Capernaum's not down here. Once again, it has to do with the elevation. And it does matter. You want to learn why the Bible says what it says, because you're trying to gain through it spiritual significance. But the point is that he had to cross over a river. I want you to see this, that there was a river that, small rivers that bled, that fed into the Sea of Galilee. He had to cross over that, and plus he had to go through this hill country in order to get to Jesus, in order to receive the healing, or to request the healing of his son. Here's a picture that shows the mountainous terrain. You can see where Capernaum is, lower in elevation. See, the Sea of Galilee is surrounded by this mountainous region, and you can see how this was an elevated climb all the way up, going from Capernaum into this into the place of Cana. And here's just another picture that shows that. And so that was just the geography. I just wanted to point that out to you, that there was it was a significant journey that this man was going to have to embark on. This wasn't an easy walk. It wasn't an easy journey to be able to take. Also, you know, anytime that we're preaching a narrative, you know, a narrative tells a story, the characters matter in the midst of the story. And in this story, we have Jesus, we have the nobleman, and we have the son that's sick unto death, right? But I want to talk to you just a second about the nobleman, because what does it even mean to be a nobleman? Well, the word literally means to be of a house of royalty. So what I need you to understand first off, right off the bat, is that this man is possibly part of the lineage of Herod, who's reigning as king, but he's of a royal house. And I don't know about you, but I would imagine that a person that comes from a royal house, he has a lot of ability to accomplish a lot of things in his life. In other words, if he's got a circumstance or a problem financially, he doesn't really probably have to come ask for prayer in that situation. He just has some money on the side, and he can fix that. He can move this to move that, and he can fix his circumstances, right? But what's interesting is that he's now found himself in the midst of a circumstance that he cannot fix. And it's a desperate situation that he has to embark upon a journey that's not an easy travel for him to make. And then also we have, and you know, I just want to tell you right now, in case I forget my point later, that God knows exactly where to get you and the circumstances to place you in order to put you and embarking on a journey that will bring you to the place where you need to get, in order to get to Jesus, in order to find what it is that you need to get. Amen? Amen. And that's exactly what God has allowed to take place in this nobleman's life. Yes. Is for him to come to a place where he would embark upon that journey, and he would find Jesus in the midst of it, so that he would get the answers that he needed. The other character that I want to talk to you about just for a second is this son that's sick unto death. You know, I started to think about it. The more I started looking at the text, the more I started seeing myself right there. That, you know what? I don't know exactly what was wrong with this young boy. All I know is that he had a fever. And a fever is a sign of a disease process. It doesn't necessarily automatically mean that there's an infection. But there's something internally going on wrong with this young boy. And the only thing that we know is that an outward manifestation, the boy is burning up. You can see, and listen, sometimes my mom and dad is coming to the clinic and they're like, oh, it was about 100.5 when I felt it. I'm like, oh, you didn't have a thermometer? Mm-hmm. No. Oh, but it felt about 100.5. I'm like, ma'am, I know I'm kind of rude sometimes. I'm like, that doesn't mean anything. But no, in reality, if I'm fair, it does mean something. Because whenever somebody's cheeks get red, and you feel their head and they're burning up, you may not be able to tell me it's 100.5. You may not be able to tell me it's 102. But you know that there's something going on, but you still don't know what it is that's going on internally. But at the same time, I'm here to tell you that God the Father has a whole bunch of children, and that they're sick unto death because they've been born with an infection that's on the inside of them. And while I'm talking about that, I would like to make the comment, or at least make the point, that the truth is this, is that we've already talked about internal versus external on multiple circumstances since we've been reading. We've talked about the fact that, remember the miracle that took place in Cana of Galilee. That a miracle took place on the inside of those vessels. We've also talked about the fact that people want to see external signs and wonders in order to believe God. And as we move a little bit further, as I'm preparing the story, you're going to also see that the two stories that sandwich in our story also contain internal versus external concepts. And the thing that I want you to remember is this, is that that's the problem with man. The problem with man is an internal problem. The problem with man is, yes, we see external evidences of an internal problem, but the real issue is that we were born of Adam. We were born of Adam, and we remember the story that Adam was created in the image and likeness of God, but after the fall, Adam had a son named Seth, who was born in the image and likeness of his father, Adam. All of humanity is in the same boat. We've all been born with an internal problem on the inside of us, and it's manifesting itself outwardly, but God has a prescription, God has a remedy, and it's the same one for you and I as it was for this nobleman. We got to get to Jesus in the midst of this journey, and no matter what we're going through and no matter how hard the travel is, God will use all of those circumstances in order to get us from point A to point B so that we'll finally surrender ourselves to Him and become desperate that He would move in the midst of our circumstances. Amen. And so here we have a son that's sick unto death. And I don't know about you, but I know that Matt has been a son that's been born sick unto death. And I need a healer. Amen. Jesus told him, he said that you know what? The well don't need a physician. Now maybe you're in here and you're well this morning. And maybe I need to preach to somebody else. Jesus said, the well don't need a physician. You know who he was talking to? The self-righteous. He's talking to the self-righteous that think that they got everything together. Got all their bills paid. They got their checkbook balanced to a T. They drive a nice car. They show up for work every day. Everything is looking good. And they look down on everybody else. And they look at the fact that, oh boy, still smoking on the pipe. Old girl over there, she hadn't changed anything. This one over there, still doing that. And they look at their life and they look at their past and they think, what good thing could come out of Nazareth? Well, I got good news for you. Hallelujah. The good thing that came out of Nazareth is the same good thing that can do something in you. Amen. Don't let nobody look down on you just because they think they got it together. Amen. That's a self-righteous spirit. Amen. And it's the worst kind of sin you can have. Right. And let me tell you why. Because when you got a self-righteous spirit, you can't see that you got an infection.
That's right. Right. Amen.
You can't see that you got a problem.
That's right.
And if you can't see you got a problem,
amen,
then you don't need a physician.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus said he came for the sick. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And so that's the situation of this young boy. Now, once again, I want to talk to you a little bit about the placement of our story. Our story is sandwiched between this dialogue of the Samaritan woman. That's one of the things I love about the Gospel of John. It's a mixture of dialogues and miracles. Dialogue and miracle. Dialogue and miracle. What are you talking about? Jesus has dialogue with various people. And we're learning the whole time. If we stop and we pay attention and we try to read a little bit deeper, that's another thing people have a hard time believing. Oh man, you're twisting the scriptures. You're looking so deep in there. I'm like, dude, you don't think that if I can write a book, something allegorically, you think God can't? You think God can't put something deeper in his story in order to give us spiritual revelation to bring us closer to him and to understand him a little bit better? No, he can, and he does, and he did. And in the dialogues, in these conversations that we see, Jesus on the front end of our story today has a dialogue with the Samaritan woman. And in that story, once again, we see the internal versus the external. It's everywhere that we look. She goes to the well looking for physical water to satisfy a physical thirst. And what Jesus wants to tell her about is living water.
Yes.
He said, any man that believes in me, he will have water, living water in him. I will give him living water. And it will come springing forth unto eternal life. And when you give your life to Jesus, I don't care how broke, bad off you were whenever you were born of Adam. When you give your life to Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit becomes resident on the inside of you. And living water starts to spring up on the inside of you. Listen to me, that doesn't mean that you're never going to make another mistake. That doesn't mean that you're never going to mess up. But whenever you start experiencing that living water, come on. See, one of the things that I love about people that have really messed up. No, well, I'm looking at a lot of different people. If I could put it. Don't mess up. If I had a mirror, I would stop and put my camera on so I could look at my own face. You think you're the only one that's messed up bad in here, bro?
No.
Come on.
Yeah.
I can start getting people to raise their hand and give their testimony.
Amen.
People sticking needles in their arms and doing all kind of other stuff.
Amen.
Come on.
Thank you, Lord.
Point that I'm trying to make is that Jesus, when he forgave that woman, none of this is in my notes, but you know what? The Lord wants you to know this.
Yeah.
When he forgave that woman, he was sitting at Simon the Pharisee's house. And that woman came in there, and she didn't, yeah, really, it doesn't look like she said a whole lot of words. She just broke that box, and she started weeping with her tears, washing his feet with her hair, weeping and weeping and weeping.
Yeah.
Because he had forgiven her. And Simon the Pharisee just looked it with disdain, and he was thinking in his heart. Wouldn't that be something if somebody just called you out like that and just told you exactly what you were thinking at that moment in time? That's what Jesus did. He perceived what was in his heart. And what Simon the Pharisee was thinking was, if he knew what kind of woman that was touching him, he must not be much of a prophet, because if he knew what kind of woman that was touching him, he wouldn't let her touch him. And what Jesus' response was to Simon the Pharisee, the self-righteous spirit, was that, to whom much is forgiven, they love much.
That's right.
And the point that I was trying to make is that when I look around and I see people that feel as though they've really messed up bad, the enemy of your soul wants to condemn you to the point. He wants to put a cloud of guilt on top of you. And if you know what I'm talking about, if you've been there before, he wants to put a cloud of guilt on top of you, and he wants to make you believe that you are unworthy and that there's nothing that you can do in order to ever make it right, that God would never want you, he would never love you. And listen to me, I'm telling you right now, there's all kind of people out there in the community, if they've watched your life, they're thinking that about you.
Yes.
And you're not going to convince them. And don't even try. Because you don't have to convince them.
Amen.
The only one that you have to live for is Jesus.
Amen.
And as you trust him, and you allow him to do what he does, he does a work on the inside of you. That living water starts to spring up. And starts to bring hope where there's hopelessness.
Yes. Yes.
And he starts to reveal to you that, you know what? Yes, you cheated on me here, 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 and here. And if it ain't for me, you might cheat on me next week. But I'm still going to love you. And I'm still going to give you grace. And I'm still going to show you that I did everything that needed to be done in order for you to live for me. And all of a sudden on the inside, as that living water starts springing up, you start feeling like that sinful woman. And you're like, I don't care what you think, Simon, Mr. Pharisee. I'm about to pour my love out on the feet of Jesus. And I'm not here to convince you. All I know is that I've been overwhelmed by the love of my Savior. Hallelujah. Don't try to convince everybody in the community that you changed. You just, you know what you do though? You live for Jesus.
That's right.
You still speak for Jesus.
That's right.
And you don't stress about all that.
That's right.
Hold on to the Lord.
Amen.
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 Don't worry. You mess up. You mess up bad enough, the enemy's going to try to keep your mouth shut long enough to where you won't say nothing for Jesus for a while. But the next thing you know, the Holy Spirit will start coming back on the inside of you and start building you up. And you won't be able to keep it back. You're going to start talking Jesus. I'm telling you, if you let the real Jesus show up and do his work on the inside of you, the devil will not be able to keep your mouth shut.
Amen.
Because when you feel the forgiveness of the Lord moving and operating in your life, you will fall in love with him.
Hallelujah.
Because you will experience his love. Amen?
Amen. That's right.
And
Amen.
You just keep on living for him. Amen? And you let him prove himself through your life.
Right.
You don't have to prove your life to them.
That's right.
You prove you let him prove himself through you. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
And it'll be up to them whether or not they choose
that's
to
right.
believe the change that's taking place in your life.
Amen.
Some will believe and some won't. So we're sitting here between the internal. She's thinking about physical water. Jesus is talking about living water.
Mm-hmm.
On the other side of our story, we have the story of the lame man at the pool of Bethesda. Physical water again. Outdated religion. What is he waiting on? You got to wait for the angel to show up and to stir the water. If you've ever read the story, John chapter
Amen.
5.
Yeah.
It said, if I'm not mistaken, he was lame for 38 years.
Yeah.
It said that there was all kind of impotent folk, meaning that they couldn't do anything. They were halt, lame, and withered. meaning that they had been lame for so long their muscles had become atrophied, dried up. There was no more juice left in their muscles because they'd just been laying there. You cannot imagine the moaning and the groaning. And everybody's waiting for an angel to show up in the old covenant to stir the water, and the first one that gets in the water, he's able to get healed. But only one. Then you gotta wait. Don't know how long we're gonna wait. We're just waiting. Waiting and moaning in our misery, hoping that God will show up and do something. And then when he does, and the water stirred, this poor guy that's been laying for 38 years says, when Jesus walks up to him, he says, "Will you be made whole?" He says, "I keep waiting. Every time the angel shows up, I want to get in there, but then somebody jumps in before me." You know, there's probably a message to preach right there. Amen. If you're waiting on somebody to help you out of your situation, you probably will be waiting a whole long time.
Amen.
But if you'll just look your eyes squarely in the eyes of Jesus and get desperate enough to let him know that you need his help, he'll reach down and he'll say, "Rise, pick up your bed, and walk." But what I want you to know is, hallelujah, that's representing Old Covenant, Old Testament theology. It's limited, and it only does external. We're seeing external water. And sandwiched in between, we have a story of the nobleman and his son that has an internal problem, and he needs an internal miracle to take place. Amen?
Amen.
And so what I want you to see, too, is this, is that, first off, regarding this man's faith, is that it's a desperate faith. I just read this right here, and I thought this was interesting. This was some notes that I wrote about the nobleman. It says, upon arriving, this nobleman, which most Greek scholars agree that he was part of an officer in King Herod's court or part of the royal family, like I told you. Church tradition says that it could have been one of these two men right here. One man named Cusa, another man named Manian, okay, out of Luke and Acts. The point is that we can't prove it. That's what church history would say, that they think that they could have been them. So we can't prove it. But this is what the Lord spoke to me when I was writing this about 4 or 5 years ago. Regarding these names offered by church history as possible candidates to represent the noblemen, we cannot prove it either way. But as I was writing those names down, the Holy Spirit began to move upon me and said, "You may never know with certainty whether either one of these men were him. But what you can know is that these names and the names of the others that they are congregated with represent lives. They represent people. They represent real individuals, and I changed their lives. And after I changed their lives, they served me with their lives. Encourage my people to serve me with their lives. Let them know that what they do for me today with their lives makes a difference for eternity." And as I read that this morning, that was really the only note that I read, to be honest with you, from that past teaching. I felt like the Lord wanted me to share that with you. We don't know exactly who this guy is, but he represents a life amongst millions of lives that had an encounter with Jesus, and he changed them. Amen? And after he changes somebody's life, what they do is they turn around and they serve him with their life. Amen? And what you do for the Lord today is going to matter in eternity. Amen? It may not go the way that you want it to today. It might not go the way you want it to next week. But if you'll stay faithful to Jesus and serve him with your life, just like he served you with his life, it's going to matter in the end. Amen? God's going to bless the work that you did. I'm going back to the nobleman, and I want to talk about his faith real quick. And first thing I want you to know is that he had a desperate faith. I mean, think about it. Here he is. He's part of the royal family. He has probably, once again, a means to accomplish the majority of the things that he would desire to be able to accomplish. But yet he has to embark upon this journey, climbing nearly 1,000 feet in elevation, 20 miles in arduous time. You can't take a horse up that. You might be able to find an ornery mule, but it'll probably just make it even worse. My point is that it's not an easy task. And you know what the truth of the matter is? Is that, once again, the task of this life isn't that easy. It's not that easy whenever you're trying to walk for the Lord. But in the midst of your journey, God will once again allow desperate circumstances to take place so that you find yourself in a situation that you can no longer fix it, and that you're going to get hungry and you're going to get desperate and you're going to embark upon a journey, and no matter what stands in your way, you're going to get yourself from point A to point B so that you can grab a hold of Jesus. And when he shows up over there, it says in verse 47, when he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea unto Galilee, he went unto him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. You know, the word besought has the concept of desperation connected to it. It's like an interrogation. In other words, he didn't just say it once. He didn't just say one time, Jesus, would you please come down and heal my son? He was pleading with it. He was begging it. It means beseech. It means to beg. It means to plead. Well, you gotta come, you got, sir. You gotta come. My child is at the point of death. And I was thinking to myself, if we were able to see ourselves the way that we really are, that it seems as though to me that sometimes we would find ourselves and hopefully come into a place of desperation. That we would, no matter how hard it was to get to him, that once we got to him, we would be desperate. And we would cry out, Lord, I beseech you. Won't you reach down? Won't you come down and do something? Because I'm in dire need. I got an infection. Yes. I got a fever that's raging on the inside of me. And I need you to show up. And I need you to do the work that only you can do in the midst of my circumstances. Amen. He was desperate for somebody to show up. And listen, and not only just for your own life, but also maybe for your children's life.
Yes.
Or also maybe for your other loved ones' lives.
Yes.
That we would become desperate. That we'd be able to move away from our own circumstances and our own mess long enough to take some time and to cry out to God and say, Lord, I need you to intervene.
Yes.
I need you to intervene in their life. I need you to intervene in my life. I need you to do something. I need you to show up. That's the first thing I wanted you to see about this nobleman's faith. He couldn't fix this situation. There might have been a whole lot of things in his past that he could fix, but this boy was on the brink of death, and he had to get a hold of Jesus. And sometimes you might find yourself in the midst of a mess, and you don't know how in the world you're going to get out of it. I'm here to tell you right now, it may look bad. The devil thinks he has you hemmed in. He thinks he's about to pull the plug and destroy you. And the reality of it is that God has allowed this whole thing to be orchestrated, and he's all just waiting for you to cry out to him. And when you cry out to him, hallelujah, Jesus shows up and he brings the remedy that you need in the midst of that situation. And he will bring the healing that you need. Amen? So number one, I want you to know that his faith, it was a desperate faith. He went and he besought him. Number two, I want you to know that his limited understanding didn't limit God. And what I mean by that is that in verse 49, the nobleman saith unto him, Sir, come down ere my child die. In other words, in this man's mind, he thinks that if Jesus doesn't come down from Cana to Capernaum, all hope is lost. Now, I will tell you that whenever I was reading it, I couldn't get past the first point, which was desperation. I just love the way that sounds. Sir, come down ere my child die. I don't know about you, but I'm thinking there's been times that I've been desperate enough to cry out, Sir, come down ere I die in the midst of my situation. If you don't show up and bring life, oh, it's going to be a big old mess. That's still part one, though. Point one. And point two, his understanding of God and how God operates is limited. I would imagine, if you can just speculate with me for a moment, that all along his arduous journey, as he's climbing up the rocks and he's moving around this and moving the mountain goats out of his way, and he's trying to go on this travel in order to get to Jesus, he's probably rehearsing in his mind because he's desperate, crying, wiping tears, and saying, what am I going to have to say to this man. I cannot leave this place without this man coming home with me, because if I leave and this is my only hope, they said that he turned water into wine. They said he had authority over the religious leaders. They said that he performed miracles in Jerusalem during the Passover feast. I got to get a hold of him, and I got to find a way to get him to come to my house.
Amen.
And then when everybody, his understanding is limited. Because see, many times we want to put God in a box, in a certain situation. We think he's only going to work this way. We want him to show up this way. And if he's not going to do it that way, then I don't want it at all. God doesn't move according to what we think. God moves according to his word and his will and his plan. He knows what's best for you. He knows what's best for your circumstances. He knows how to move and operate in your lives to get the most effective thing that he desires out of you. Sir, come down here, my child died. Jesus' response to him is, in verse 50, Jesus says unto him, go your way, your son lives. The man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. See, the fact of the matter is this. This boy has got an infection on the inside of him. He's got some kind of a disease process that has riddled his body and is about to bring him to the point of death. And this man believes that Jesus has to come down and physically touch him. And what Jesus does is he speaks a word. Mm-hmm. He speaks a word and he tells him, no, you're already healed. Your son is already healed. Now, start walking. And the Lord would say to you and I about our infection, about our disease, about our problem, no, you're already healed.
Yes. Amen.
The word of God says that you're already healed.
Yes.
I am the word that became flesh. I am the remedy for your problem. I've already gone to the cross and I offered myself up in your stead. And now you have access to grace. Start walking.
Yes,
start walking and believing and start trusting me. And as you do, as you step out in faith, you're going to see my hand all over the midst of this situation.
Lord.
And you're going to find out that you've been made whole. Amen? Now the good news is this, is that on the way back, the servants of the nobleman meet him somewhere along the journey in order to tell him the good news. They tell him that your boy or your child, he lives. And he wants to know, the nobleman wants to know, what hour was it that he began to amend? Oh, they said it was the seventh hour. Now, I don't think that's coincidental. See, God did all of his work on 6 days, and on the seventh day, he rested. And the reason why was because creation was a completed work. And the truth is that now Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. Why? Because he's resting. Hallelujah. Yeah. Because Calvary is a completed work. Yeah. And I got good news for you. This boy's infection was healed on the seventh hour because Calvary is a completed work. And yours and my infection, our problem that we received from Adam, has already been healed.
Amen.
Because Calvary is a completed work. We just got to trust him. We got to keep trusting him. Even if you mess up tomorrow, you still got to keep trusting him. You got to keep holding on. Brother Swagger said something one time on TV, and Joseph Larson mentioned it before. He said, Brother Swagger said this, if you won't quit, he won't quit.
Right.
No matter what you, don't quit on the Lord. The enemy wants to condemn you. He wants to beat you down. He wants to tell you that you're unworthy. He wants to bring all kinds of circumstances your way. And he wants to try to cause you to turn away from the Lord.
Yes.
I was thinking the other day, you know, sometimes in the trials of life, they get the best of us. They try to get the best of us. I remember praying a prayer. I said, you know, Lord, no matter what I go through in this life, I pray that you do me a favor. Weld my hands to the plow.
Mm.
I never prayed a prayer like that before. It just kind of came out of my mouth. Mm. Weld my hands to the plow. Make it such that I cannot remove my hands from what it is that you've called me to do. No matter what I go through, no matter what the enemy brings my way, no matter what kind of things that I face, no matter what kind of circumstances, weld my hands to the plow, Lord. And you know, the next day, I didn't plan on sharing this, but the next day it was of such an encouragement. The next day, this young guy, well, I'll say his name, Chance Wise, sent me a text. I hadn't heard from him in forever, and he sends me a text. He goes, hey, man, I just wanted to let you know, Chance is a very intelligent young man. He's very knowledgeable about the word. But he said, I do this gaming thing on the computer. And obviously he plays games with people worldwide. And he said there was this one guy in Norway that I was playing games with, and he was an atheist. And he said, I tried to talk to him about the faith. He said, actually, I gave him everything that I knew to talk to him about Christianity in an attempt to convince him that this way was the right way. He said, most of these guys are probably very intellectual. And Chance just made the comment that he said he basically kind of thought that I was silly and that whatever I was believing was kind of ridiculous, but he was respectful. And he said, I just left him with some things to check out, and one of them was the videos to your YouTube stuff. He said, I hadn't heard from the dude in 5 months. He said he texted me the other day, or messaged me, whatever, and said, hey man, are you still a Christian? He said, because I'm a born-again Christian now.
Wow.
Amen. And Chance said, well, dude, what did it? He said, those videos that you left me, whatever that guy was saying. He said, man, I started watching those videos, and I started studying, and I started researching, and I looked into creationism. And he said, I gave my heart to Jesus, and now there's a bunch of us, and we meet together. And Chance said, I just wanted to let you know that you had something to do with some dude in Norway getting saved. I thought you might want to know that. Praise God, it's just one little piece of the puzzle. We all just a little piece of the puzzle. God called you to preach. God might call you to play some games. I don't know what kind of games you're playing, but I hope it's all right. And so my point is that, you know what? You meet people, and you share your faith with people, and you try to let your light shine in the midst of darkness. And all from a simple prayer, Lord, weld my hands to the plow. The Lord just dropped a little bit of encouragement. Come on, son. Don't turn your back.
Amen.
Keep on moving. Keep on plowing. The enemy's going to tell you that you're unworthy to be a witness. The enemy's going to try to tell me that I'm unworthy to be a preacher of the gospel. Fact of the matter is, God chose the foolishness of preaching to confound the wise. Jesus is the perfect one. He's the righteous one. Hallelujah. Our job is to let the word of God move and operate in our lives and to be a witness of it in the lives of other people. Amen. Listen, this man's understanding was limited about how Jesus and how the Lord operates, but his limited understanding did not limit the Lord. The Lord said, your son has been made whole. Get to walking, get to trusting. And guess what? It was a completed hour, the seventh hour. It was a fulfilled hour. The work had been done. The last thing I want you to see about this man's faith, I'm not closing yet, but the last thing I want you to see about this man's faith was this. I wanted you to see that his faith was contagious. Look at what it says in verse 53. It says in verse 53, so the father knew that it was at the same hour in the which Jesus said unto him, your son liveth, and himself believed, and his whole house. Now there's a whole lot of stories that I could give you examples to, but the first two that popped in my mind was the Samaritan woman in the story in chapter 4. If you'll remember that story, it's a beautiful story.
Mm-hmm.
She was trying so hard to find fulfillment on this earth. Man after man. That's her story. It's the story of a lot of women. Looking, it's the story of a lot of men. Looking for love. I'm almost singing that old country and western song, but
in the wrong place.
Looking for love.
That's right.
And there is real love on this earth. I believe that. But if you ain't waiting for the right timing, and sometimes you may not find it, and if you jump into it, and you thought that that was it, and you only find out that it wasn't, and you're not letting Jesus be the love of your life,
amen,
you're going to have a mess on your hands.
Amen to that.
You got an even bigger mess than what you started with.
Amen.
And so, you know what? There she was. She was left empty. Man after man after man after man. Jesus told her, he said, go get your husband. I don't have a husband. He said, this you say is true. You've had 5 already, and the one that you're living with now is not your husband. But you know what? I heard a young man preach down here recently, and he said, I just know Jesus was being sweet to her. Well, geez, everything Jesus does is sweet. But he sure enough called her out.
Yes.
He sure enough told her the truth. You can't be scared to tell people the truth.
Amen.
Amen. The word of God is the word of God, and you can't live contrary to it. I don't care who you are.
Amen.
But when it was all said and done, the way Jesus handled his business, something took place on the inside of her, a radical internal transformation. Oh, she started to experience that living water that he was talking about. She turned around, she went back to the town, and she started telling, it says specifically the men of the town. Yeah. I know because I preached it twice. I would imagine at this point in time, come on somebody, you got to get a hold of this. You think that woman didn't ever walk around with her eyes down? I didn't plan on preaching on the Samaritan woman, but let's talk about it for just a second. You think she didn't have to walk around with her eyes down? As a matter of fact, I remember when I preached the text, she showed up at the well at a time that nobody else did. She was probably a social outcast. Everybody was talking bad about her. Everybody condemned her because of her past. Oh, she'll never be any different. Oh, hallelujah. When living water got on the inside of her, she didn't care what they thought. As a matter of fact, all the men I've been sleeping with, they need to hear about this Jesus that told me everything that I ever did. I could see her going to the town and looking them all in the eyeballs, no longer ashamed, no longer full of fear, no longer downcast and downtrodden. Instead, the light of God living and bubbling on the inside of her. Hey, I found him. I found the one that they promised was coming. And look, he told me everything that I ever did. But now I got the life of God on the inside of me. Hallelujah. Listen to me. The noble man's faith turned contagious because his whole household gave their life to Jesus. Amen. The Samaritan woman's faith got contagious because the Bible says that half the town followed her back to find Jesus. The Philippian jailer. Remember that story? Paul and Silas, beaten, their back beaten to shreds in the midst of the midnight hour, begin to sing hymns unto the Lord. The earth quakes, the shackles break, the door of the prison opens up. The jailer's about to kill himself. Paul knows it and says, hey, don't kill yourself. We haven't left. We're still here. The jailer gets saved, and his whole household gets saved with him. People's faith is contagious. Hallelujah. When you live for Jesus and you let the light of Jesus come out of you, it becomes contagious. People start to experience it. They see it. They want what you got. Amen. Let Jesus live in you. Amen. Let Jesus live through you. All right. I'm closing now. But as I do, I'm getting a little bit deeper. I'm not going to close with fluff. I'm going to close with depth. Fever. Fever reminds me of an internal struggle that's taking place on the inside of the body. Many of you are moms, right? I know daddy didn't pay attention to all that, but whenever you brought your kid to the clinic, what did the doctor say? Don't stress about the fever. Fever is part of the body's natural response to infection. This is what the body does. It's building an immune response to the infection. Right? Whenever it's an infection anyway. And so what we see is an internal struggle going on. There's something on the inside of the body that's foreign to the body. It's not supposed to belong there. And the fever is attempting to mount a defense against it. In medicine, we call these signs and symptoms. A sign is like a rash. I can see it. It's a physical thing on the outside that helps me, along with other information, to try to come to a conclusion. Fever is more of a symptom. You can't see it unless you read it on a thermometer, but you know something's there because next thing you know, like I said, the cheeks get red, you can feel the heat. But it's showing me externally something that's taking place on the inside. Mm-hmm. Turn with me to Galatians chapter 5, verse 17. The Lord wanted me to tell you this morning that fever in this young boy was something that we could see externally, but it was telling us about something that was internal. And in a similar way, God wants you and I to know that there's a struggle that's taking place on the inside of us, and that there's certain clues that will show us whenever things aren't operating the way that they're supposed to. Galatians 5:17 says this, "For the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh." What does that mean? Your flesh is descriptive of your fallen nature that you received from Adam. Even though you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and your sinful nature is supposed to lie dormant, it's not eradicated. It's still in there, and believe me, it wants to come back to life really bad. The only thing that can keep it dead is continued faith in Jesus and His power over sin, hell, and the grave. Amen? And so, but at the same time, there's an internal struggle that takes place in the life of the believer. I'm telling you right now, just as soon as you think you got it all figured out, bam! And don't think that the Lord doesn't let it happen, because He knows you better than you know yourself. And just as you thought you'd never be prideful again because of all the things that you've been through, you didn't even know it, but you were starting to get puffed up, and the Lord allowed a little orchestration direction of something to happen. And guess what? He knew just what to place in your path to bring you down a notch, to show you you wasn't all that you thought you was to begin with. But I'm here to tell you that there's a struggle that takes place on the inside.
Yes.
Your sinful nature battling against the Holy Ghost that lives in you. And the Holy Spirit is desiring to be the overcomer in there. But many times we're unwilling to surrender those things in our lives. And this battle continues to rage on the inside of us. And he goes on to say in verse 17, the spirit against the flesh against the spirit. They're contrary one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. I got bad news and I got good news. You can't do it. Good news is Jesus already did it.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Lord.
And you look, you trust in him and you look to him, and he will continue to show up in the midst of your circumstances. Amen. Amen. And he will continue to give you the victory that you desire in your life. Now, I just real quick, just like that fever was something on the outside showing us that there was something going wrong on the inside, I wanted you to see real quick about these lusts of the flesh. See, the lust of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit are external things that you and I can see. We can't see all of them because sometimes we hide them. We're not going to let you see whenever we're committing adultery. We're not going to let you see whenever we're committing fornication. But sometimes you can't hide some of these things. I mean, and you don't always hide them anyway, because the Word of God says your sin will be revealed. So you continue to live in chronic sin. The fact of the matter is that it will be exposed.
Yes.
God's merciful and gracious, but at some point in time it runs out. And it's exposed. And the Word of God says right here, though, that there's other lusts of the flesh. One of them is called variance. It's a love of strife. You ever seen somebody like that before?
Yes.
No matter where they go, they ain't doing nothing but causing a big old mess.
Drama.
Going to cause this one to be mad at that one, and that one to be mad at that one, and can't let nothing go.
Amen.
Every time you see you're around them, they're over there talking about him and this, that, and the other thing. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of that.
Yeah,
I'm done. Lord, change me.
Yeah.
Because listen to me, I've been that way before. Don't think that I haven't. I'm kind of ashamed of myself that I wasted that much breath and time on trying to cause such a mess between other people. Like, I didn't have enough of my own mess to deal with that I had to try to create mess in other people's lives. Oh, Lord, forgive me. How silly am I? It's like the Jerry Springer show. What's going on? Do I really take joy out of that? Sometimes I used to watch that show a little bit. And I would watch it for, and listen, this is after the Lord got a hold of me. I'm thinking to myself, how do people live like this? And the Lord said, you used to live just like that. What are you talking about? You wasn't, everything was hollering and screaming and yelling and fighting. Oh man, I don't even have enough time for that anymore. Dude, like, I'm weary. You hear me? I'll try to yell sometimes. Well, I mean, every now and then I do yell. The girls might be laughing at it. Don't laugh to the people. But you know, I don't laugh. I don't yell for long. Because I'm too tired to get up and all that yelling.
Amen.
And it ain't going to do any good.
Amen.
Lord, help me. I don't want to. Amen. I don't want to be a lover of strife. I don't. You know what? I don't want your life to be a mess.
Right.
You ever thought of that?
Thank you, Lord.
I'm not so miserable anymore that I want your life to be a mess. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
I want you to be happy.
Amen.
I want you to walk in victory.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to cause a big old mess in your life. Fact of the matter is, you might have done me wrong. You might have done something real bad. I can't fix it. It's not my job to convince everybody that you were wrong and I was right. The Lord wants to take your defense.
Amen.
That's another thing right there. You're not going to convince them all that you're really saved, and you're not going to convince them all you were right. Let him be your attorney.
Amen.
Let him bring peace to your heart.
Amen.
Amen.
Boy, that's good right there.
That's
good. It didn't do with the message, but it's like, I wonder why strife keeps following these people around. And it's probably because they have not learned to allow God to take their defense. And God just keeps on letting the quarrel rage. God keeps on letting the mess happen. And he's just letting them know, someday you're going to come to the place where you're going to get tired of this. And you're going to surrender this thing in your life. And I'm going to move in the midst of your circumstances.
Amen.
Emulations, envy, anger, jealousy. You know, fact of the matter is I've shared this with you before. I've seen people preach before, and I'm sitting there in the audience. This is after Jesus got a hold of my heart. I'm sitting there thinking, man, I can preach better than that dude. What's he up there for? I shouldn't admit that to you. I'm just being honest. I don't think that way anymore, praise God. You're either preaching the truth or you're not. I'm not looking at your style.
Amen.
It's not that I've never said whenever somebody's preaching, I wish he wasn't preaching. But I'm not sitting there thinking anymore I can preach better than that because I know I'm not the greatest preacher, okay? But my point is this. Sometimes you look at what somebody else is doing. You look at that God elevated them, put them in a certain position, did this with them, done that with them. And in your heart, you're thinking, why do they get that opportunity? That should be my opportunity. Well, hold on a second. You don't know what that person's been through. You don't know what they've been doing. You don't know what God has been preparing them for. And not only that, you don't know what's in your heart.
Right on.
God might be trying to show you something that's in your heart. Maybe you thought you were further along than what you really were. See, these are beautiful lusts of the flesh because sometimes, yes, we can see them on the outside because we might see the little face you make whenever we notice something's going on. We might be able to deduct what's happening in your heart. That's possible. But the fact is, too, though, that sometimes these things are just in there, and if we don't ever talk about it, man, listen, the Holy Spirit wants to draw that stuff out. Amen?
Amen.
Seditions. Division. I'm telling you right now, this church hadn't been started, wasn't even started yet, and within the first week, the enemy had showed up in this place while we were still scraping the floor and was already starting to cause division. I'm telling you right now, and you know what? Then people aren't here anymore. And all I can say is, good. Because the fact of the matter is that they were doing nothing but causing division. And the Lord don't want you here. And I'll be honest with you, I didn't put it down. Maybe I didn't put it down because I didn't want y'all to know I had a problem with it. But that day, I started to go off in the lust of the flesh called wrath. Which is an anger that is uncontrollable and is demonic. It's different than the one Jesus had. Jesus' anger was a righteous anger. And when then people started coming up in here and causing division and strife and started saying some of the things they did to me, I can remember, I felt the anger rising up in me. I don't know, I like to try to say it was righteous anger later, but people that saw it told me, no, it wasn't. It wasn't that righteous about you, bro. You were in the flesh. It's good to have people around you that'll tell you the truth. Amen?